Why do they call these people stars? Aren't they anti-stars, the celebrities? Aren't they anti-celebrities? Just something to think about. In Syria, there's this red line, right? They're supposed, the red line is the use of chemicals. And if that red line is crossed, then supposedly that's when action is taken. Well, there's another red line. That other red line is a line that the Holy Spirit has drawn and says, look, once things step over this red line, then the Holy Spirit is going to take action to protect those who to protect the faithful, those who put their faith in the Holy Spirit. Why? The purpose of the ego, especially as it's playing out in this world, it becomes apparent, is to try and eliminate any competition from itself. It wants to get rid of the presence of the Holy Spirit entirely, annihilate it. Because the Holy Spirit points out that the ego doesn't have any solution of the continuity problem. And so the only way that the ego can maintain your loyalty to it is to say there's no option. There's no other option. That's its ultimate logic. There is no other option. But it pursues that logic as an attempt to annihilate the presence of the Holy Spirit, to get rid of it. Problem is, it's within all of us. The Holy Spirit is an intrinsic part, aspect of all of us. So what we do then is we project it outward, this inner aspect of ourselves, with the advice of the ego, project it outwards, project it on a symbol, something out there, and then attack that thing out there. And that's what's happening in this world. We're demonizing and attacking that which we feel represents, you know, spiritual wisdom of the Holy Spirit. The ultimate objective, again, of all this, there's really been a spiritual war raging on this planet for quite some time, and decades and decades. And this war, again, is the ego's war against what I call religion, which at its very root is based on the fact of the Holy Spirit. The fact of the Holy Spirit, which is a fact most people don't know about. Because remember, prior to Spirit trying to become prime creator, there was no Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit was created by God as specifically to resolve the continuity problem that Spirit has in dropping this training program to learn how to die, which is existence, which is how it's trying to become prime creator. There's a continuity problem there, and God created the Holy Spirit to resolve this continuity problem. So most people are ignorant that there's such a thing as the Holy Spirit, that within us, this capacity to reason perfectly, to clarify perfectly, to stretch time perfectly, to give this a new perception to us. All of this within us, we have this within us, and the ego doesn't really. The ego feels very threatened by this, extremely threatened, because it's our advisor on how to die. You see, we wanted to become prime creator. We had to therefore get rid of what we already are, so we need to die to what we are. The mind said okay, because the mind's our servant. The mind says okay, here's the way. And then this combination of this training program that we have is of impermanence, is designed to supposedly teach us how to undergo a spiritual death. And the ego is just all the advice we get on how to die, and all the defensiveness against dropping this training program, and against listening to God, listening to the Holy Spirit, and finding out there is a way to drop this training program without suffering from this continuity issue. So the ego, again, is at war, is trying to wipe out religion on this planet, especially institutions. It wants to get rid of the very idea of spiritual institutions. The very notion in our minds, like, hey, you know what, we could structure a world with religious spiritual institutions, and therefore we could spend our whole life being constantly reminded about the Holy Spirit and the fact that it solves the continuity problem, which means we don't need this, we can drop this training exercise of death and impermanence. that we have devised for ourselves. God didn't devise it. We devised it. The mind devised it for us because we told the mind, this is what we want. So we have this intense war of the ego against the very notion of the usage of time to turn to the Holy Spirit. That's its purpose. It's not enough to just get rid of the religious institutions on the planet. It wants to get rid of the very notion that such a thing is possible. So it will never arise again. It doesn't want the Holy Spirit to ever rise again. It thinks it's some kind of virus. The ego thinks the Holy Spirit is some terrible, deadly virus that's going to lead us to, you know, complete chaos and confusion, where it's actually the ego's plan is leading us to mental chaos, where we try to hold mutual exclusives together. And to be successful and meaningful with both mutual exclusives, to be successful with both, that leads to mental chaos. It's the ego that does that, but the ego projects that on the Holy Spirit and blames the Holy Spirit for it. So here we have this war. We have an intense war that the ego has been waging socially, culturally, ideationally, okay, legally. It's a war of ideas, a war of concepts, a war of focus, a war of attention, a war of belief, a war of faith, all this stuff. It's at war with the very notion of paying attention to the Holy Spirit and clarifying the situation. Now, the red line, the Holy Spirit knows that there's a red line that when that gets crossed, when certain factors happen and gets crossed, then those who have faith in the Holy Spirit are truly at risk. Just like when Syria releases or somebody releases poison gas, it could be a false flag. It's possible. The rebels could have done it too, and then blamed it on Syria to get the intervention, etc. It's very possible. But either way, when that poison gas chemical agents are used, then that's okay. Said okay, time to intervene because things are becoming inhumane. You know, there's an intervention there. Same thing with the Holy Spirit. When certain things in this world become too vicious, the Holy Spirit says, okay, I'm going to intervene. What does that mean, it's going to intervene? We will find out very soon, because that line has been crossed. And we don't understand what that line is exactly, and what events actually crossed it. I have, you know, some guesses, guesstimates, etc. But the Holy Spirit sees the entire situation and knows everything about all time and circumstances, etc. So it knows when that line has been crossed, and I feel that line has been crossed. We are in a time now when that line has been crossed. And the Holy Spirit is going to take action. What is that action going to be? I have some guesses about what that is going to be. And it's probably going to happen very soon, maybe even by Wednesday, the 28th of August. The 28th of August is a very important day, actually, in the world. Very important day. As I said, the end of August, we need the breakthrough. August is the month of breakthroughs. By the end of August, we are going to find out what kind of trouble we're in. The end of August, it's almost here, a couple days away. I believe the red line has been crossed. The culture, The war of the ego is through culture, a lot is through culture and images and actions and ways of dressing, behaving, talking, acting, everything, trying to divert us away from the Holy Spirit. Just like religious institutions do everything they can to try and keep us focused on the Holy Spirit. The ego tries to do everything to divert us away from it. And by the 28th, I believe the line will be crossed. And so that the Holy Spirit may intervene right away, and send us some way to protect us from this cultural meltdown this terrible, and the songs, the sirens are going to sing to us, which they are singing now, to attract us to the ego's, you know, program, to the side of the ego, to attract us. The ego is using so many agents, Antichrist agents, actually, in the world right now, to try to attract us to its culture, to its program, to the way it wants civilization to be, and, you know, they use all the different forms of attractiveness, all different forms of attractiveness, flesh-based attractiveness. That's what the ego trades in. So you have all this very raunchy, very seductive stuff taking place in the world. And at some point, the Holy Spirit says that, you know, that's crossed the line. It's going to be too damaging now. Time to bring something onto the scene, which shows us, whoa, you know, doesn't it, that purity, chastity, purity, a certain focus away from the flesh, is way more attractive than all this raunchiness. Okay. And this is the way. This is the way. And this leads us to what the focus that Jesus wants told us we must have, which is the Holy Spirit and its solution to the continuity issue. So for the last couple of weeks, I've been waking up at 3 a.m. I just terrible. And this morning was the worst. I couldn't get back to sleep. I had panic attack, anxiety attacks, terrible anxiety attacks. And all day, my body's just racing like this. So something is certainly going on. Probably the start of World War III is coming up, in which I've said World War III is going to happen sooner than we know. And just like clockwork, right on the money, this gas attack is the goddess of destructivity, which is the ego at work, basically instigating this whole situation. So, once the wheels start going, as everyone knows, once you start pushing, the war machine goes forward, it's very hard to put it in reverse. And, of course, the comet, our friend the comet is coming in, and people are saying all sorts of things about the comet. You know, it's 666 years since the terrible comet Negra brought the Black Death. It's 66 years since Israel has been established. And, you know, there's all sorts of things. Different numerology is popping up all over the place. There's someone saying, oh, there's a ascension ship coming behind the comet, you know. And so it's popcorn is popping all over the place right now. But what nobody is talking about is what I'm saying here is the intervention of the Holy Spirit right now to send something into the world that is able to shame, you know, the ego, and people just say, oh my gosh, this is so much better, and to turn people away from this extremely rotten Antichrist focus in the world right now that is pouring out upon the world like sewage from movies, from television, from books, from magazines, from the internet, etc., 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 etc. Just this incredibly, you know, just rotten sleaze by these anti-stars, and just an overall atheistic, you know, hatred by lazy people who feel that you know that if they follow the ego, they'll never have to make any effort, you know. But no pain, no gain. You know, if you want to achieve something, you have to put the effort in. And somehow they feel they'd rather just sit back and watch the sleaze and stuff their faces, rather than get on the straight and narrow way and do the necessary clarification work. And so they have to do it at some time. It's inevitable. We have to set this training exercise down eventually because it doesn't work. And we'll get tired of it. And there's that continuity problem. So we have to all eventually tackle this issue. You can't default on it. The ego tells us, oh, we can default on it, or we can do both. That's his ultimate solution. No, don't worry, he says. Do both. We'll do both. We'll do both. We'll learn how to die, be annihilated spiritually, and we'll also learn to recognize that we cannot be annihilated spiritually. We do both of those. That's the ego's ultimate solution, which is total madness, which is that gives you a sense of total discontinuity, feeling, disoriented, severe disorientation, like eternal feeling of eternal disorientation when you try to succeed at mutual exclusives. That's the ego's solution. That's his ultimate ace up its sleeve, the joker in the deck that the ego has for us. And it blames the Holy Spirit for that. No. So the ego's just a total liar and deceiver, and it is behind what's going on in the world, the degeneracy of the world. It's the ego that is advising everyone on that path, thinking that everyone thinks, oh, this is going to save me a lot of work and effort. Well, temporarily it might, but the effort is still necessary. So you're just delaying, and making things more difficult by, demonizing it. You should not demonize the institutions that are set up to help and encourage and help us focus in on the Holy Spirit, so we can gradually recognize that it's the one that's telling us the truth, and the ego is the one that is lying. You see, the ego is such an incredible, clever liar. And we want to believe the ego so much that we're confused over who's telling the truth. Is it the Holy Spirit or the ego? We're very confused. So it requires a tremendous effort to figure out which one's telling the truth and not both. You see, the ego says, well, we're both telling the truth. And then you say, okay, I'll just believe both of you equally. And then your mind just comes unglued, as it were. It's not both. The ego is lying. We cannot learn how to die spiritually. All this form, we're just identifying with all this form. This form is just a phantasmagoric play of energy, giving the appearance of impermanence. And we just identify with it as a training exercise. But it's not us. It's not spirit. Form is not spirit. Nothing is dying. Spirit is not dying. Never can. And the idea that God somehow, to help us, he had such mercy, pity on us, decided to kill his only son, meaning killing spirit for us, is nonsense. Spirit cannot be killed. Nothing in reality can die. God cannot kill his only begotten son. That is impossible. That's the ego. And the ego combines that with other Holy Spirit teachings. Let's believe both. Here's the solution, everybody. I have the solution. Let's believe both. Let's believe both lies and truth. That's the ego saying that. Let's believe both lies and truth, and problem solved. No more problems. Wrong. So my feeling is that this red line that the Holy Spirit has been crossed. It has been crossed. And the Holy Spirit says, okay, here we go now. Here we go. So I've gotten unmistakable foreshadowing of this, and something is going to happen pretty amazing, actually. I'm not going to say what it is right here. We'll have to wait and see. But it'll blow your mind. I mean, it's something you haven't thought of, for sure. And it'll make a difference, a big difference, because it will make all this rotten flesh that the ego is purveying, to the world. You'll see it for what it is. You say, that's just like stinking rotten. I don't want that. I don't want that. It's terrible. And the interest will just drop like a lead balloon. Your interest and all that will just gone. Delete all the files. You'll delete all the files within you that all this stuff within you. You say, I don't want to even turn to that anymore. And that'll free up all the space within you. Now, I was driving home today, and I was thinking about the sun, and how far away is it? I don't know how far away the sun is. I can look it up, Google it, of course, but it's some odd millions of miles. And then I started thinking, I said, well, wait a minute, that's not very far at all. I mean, we've just parked this planet is parked quite near the sun. We tend to think of the sun as, it's just some abstract thing, so distant. It's not that distant at all. We're pretty close to the sun, and we're close to the planets. And I began thinking spatially in like a cosmic way. And suddenly all the spatial parameters changed, and I found a neighborhood. And nothing is very far away at all. Planets aren't far away from us. The sun is not far away from us. But what's you know, some millions of miles is nothing. It's nothing, really. If you start thinking about it, you drive 1,000 miles, which I just did this, you know, past week. I drove over 1,000 miles. Well, do that 1,000 times, right? You got 1,000,000 miles, don't you? If you do it 100, you got 100,000. Do it 1,000, you have 1,000,000 miles. So just drive the distance I drove 1,000 times. That's not that big of a deal. And that's 1,000,000 miles right there. And then, you know, do that, you know, number of times, you build up millions of miles. Millions of miles are not that far at all, actually. So I started feeling cosmically. I was aware of a cosmic consciousness. I said, wow, that's how I used to feel when I was young. That's why I spoke in a completely different way than the people who just had no idea what I was talking about, because I had a cosmic consciousness when I was young. I was able to see extraterrestrials and all sorts of light beings and everything that was happening. I saw it. I could see, you know, long distances and everything. There's a cosmic awareness of the solar system, and even the solar system, the galaxy, everything you can think in a universal dimension without feeling lost or small at all. It's cosmic consciousness. I realized, oh my gosh, I used to have cosmic consciousness. And then it got pushed down to feel you're this little person here, this little hand, on this massive planet, you know, just incredibly isolated and with impossible distances and all that stuff. And that's not true. Just a slight shift in perspective. You say, whoa, yeah, we're just, everything's close. Everything's close. Distance is not, distance no longer becomes this boogeyman for us. So great changes in place for us. And you know, this comet is streaking in. I mean, the moon, I used to feel I could reach out and touch the moon. It's so close. I said, what are you, it's so close. What are you talking about? Far away. It's not far away. It's right there. It's right there. It's right in our pockets, you know, the moon. And this comet's coming in. You know, it's just busy, you know, busying the neighborhood. It might cause a lot of problems for sure. But we can shift into this cosmic consciousness. Absolutely. It's just like a piece of cake. I just started thinking about how far is the sun really? That's what I asked. I said, how far is the sun really away from here? And I thought, you know what? It's not very far at all. We're actually very close to the sun. Yeah. I mean, and our mind is able to reach out and touch the sun, actually. I mean, the mind is not bound by distance and space, really. It's not. It's just when we think that from the standpoint of the brain, the person, that we get this sense of smallness and isolation. But if you think from the cosmic mind standpoint, it's very different. Very different. I said, hey, I like this a lot. I like this a lot. So cosmic consciousness could be coming to a lot of us, actually, at this time. I found it like just as easy as putting on a shoe, you know. It was like, wow. And it could be growing. Cosmic consciousness could be growing. And there also, again, could be a protection against the extreme immorality of the times, which is, again, an attempt to seduce the world over to the side of the ego and its relentless obsession with trying to stamp out, you know, the Holy Spirit. We could get help with that. I expect help with that, because this extreme moral degeneration is a really very bad thing. And then when you get the sirens starting to sing their songs, that makes it all seem very kind of beautiful and glitzy and glamoury, and, you know, it's a very bad thing, actually. I'm protected against that. The Holy Spirit made sure I was protected against that, because that's music is a very, very powerful tool that the ego uses, actually. Very dangerous tool. And I was in church yesterday, and for some reason my voice was like incredible, and I was just like, whoa, where'd that come from? And I started singing, it was like real loud and booming and resonant, and I started playing with the voice, and I was able to smooth it out, and I was just like, whoa, I was singing like so incredibly well. I say, huh, where'd that come from? And then something happened, very interesting. I won't say what happened, but something that tipped me off that the sirens are about to sing in this world. And then I said, you know what? It doesn't bother me at all. I can out-sing any siren, which is true. If I want to, if I need to, I can. I really can. And so the whole idea, well, the Holy Spirit is going to leave you without any entertainment, no music, anything, is nonsense. If I need to, I can provide my own entertainment for myself that's better, that I enjoy better than any siren song. That is a fact. So that just struck me. I said, no, you know, I can out-sing any of those sirens. No problem about it. No problem. It's a deeper, it's a richer, it's a more soulful, you know, everything is better. It's not just all this clever, glitzy, glamoury stuff that the sirens use, you know. But if I don't feel like singing that way, I don't, you know. So I can sing terrible if I want to also. It's not like I feel like I have to, but if I wanted to, I can do it. I just, in church, it just happened. I said, oh my gosh, you know, I can sing as good as I want to sing, actually. So that is a protection against this musical thing which is happening. The ego is frantically using music, and it's going to activate. There's a lot of unholy alliances in this world, a lot of unholy alliances that have taken place, and I'm not going to go chapter and verse on all those, but I'm very aware of those alliances. It's not a pretty picture. People have gotten into bed with one another. Very, very nasty alliances actually are taking place. You know, each one says, hey, I can help you out what you want. The other says, well, I can help you out what you want. And just like the world, there's all these alliances among states, like Syria has, you know, Russia, Iran, Hezbollah, and, you know, various alliances, and the other coalitions have their alliances and stuff. That's gone on throughout history. And a lot of times the alliances are uneasy alliances. So in this world right now, there are many very unholy alliances between groups, between large facets of the planet, aligning with aspects of the ego, you know, agents of the ego, thinking that they can get something. If they help the ego's going to help them, you know, like a siren say, hey, you, I'm going to help attract people to you, to your ideology, and in turn, you're going to make me famous, powerful, you're going to put me on stage, many people are going to hear how great a singer I am, and that kind of thing, you know, and the singers are willing to sell out. They're saying, hey, you know, it'd be great if so many people listen to me. Maybe they'd be inspired. And so they're willing to cut a deal with the ego. It's called making a deal with the devil. And sure, the devil will put them on stage. And they'll become famous and et cetera, et cetera. But the price, the ego extracts a horrible, horrible, fearsome price for that. It doesn't turn out the way that they'd hoped. So, It's the ego finds it easy to seduce musicians, very easy, because all musicians just say, oh, if people just heard my music, you know, it would make a difference. So the ego says, hey, I'll help you, I'll help you, you know, I'll get people to listen to your music, and down you go, down that terrible path. So the siren song, you how do we turn away from it? You know, there might be some very powerful singers coming onto the scene very soon. And a lot of singers, maybe the whole world will be filled with song, you know, these sirens singing these songs. A lot of females, and maybe some males too, but probably more oriented towards the females now. The entire ego's effort is employing a lot of females, actually. And because they thought, hey, you know, I get it. I want to get on the stage. I want to be noticed. You know, that kind of dynamic. And it was easy for the ego to say, oh, I'll arrange. I'll give you power. I'll give you fame and everything you want. I want to be president. I want to do this. Ego said, hey, no problem. Let's help one another. And that's the situation we have in the world. But there, of course, there are a lot of women who said, no. This is a trick. This is a trick. No way. And this, the spiritual path of recognizing the Holy Spirit is a tough path for everyone. It is tough, and you have to make sacrifices. You have to discipline your life. You have to realize that there are some things that you need to give up. You can't do it all. You can't multitask and do it all. You cannot. And so you you have to accept certain limitations on your life. You say, okay, maybe I'm not going to be president. I'm not going to be famous. I'm not going to, you know, be a big CEO. I'm not going to be a big star. All these things that the ego can give you, you say, no. That's a terrible waste of my time. I'd rather be humble, anonymous, and working on it nonstop. See, that's intelligence. But the ego is very, very clever in how it seduces and says, hey, you know, how come you're not, you know, a politician? How come the men are doing this? Well, there are certain things that men do, and there are certain things that women do, and there is this basic division of roles because it helps the path, the spiritual path, to do it that way, instead of everybody trying to do everything, which makes it impossible on this planet. If everybody's just competing desperately to do, you know, to fulfill each other's roles, you know, trying to do it all, you end up not paying attention to the Holy Spirit. So what you do is you have pretty set roles, and there's not all this social climbing, all these competition between the genders, all that stuff is a no-no, because it wastes time, it deflects your attention, etc., etc., etc. Very bad stuff. But the ego promotes it like, you know, liberation, freedom, success. Here, finally, you're getting success. No, you're making a deal with the devil is what's happening. That is really what's happening. And because you are actually helping the ego distract everyone away from the Holy Spirit. And it's objective to permanently wean us away from the Holy Spirit and convince us that the Holy Spirit is just a myth. And it is a sign of insanity. That's what the ego wants to convince everybody, that belief in the Holy Spirit is a sure sign of insanity. And indeed, desperate treatment for it. That is what the ego is trying to tell us. And that the structure that's set up to facilitate focus on the Holy Spirit is some kind of repressive, sexist, bigoted, racist structure that needs to be annihilated. That is what the ego is trying to teach us. And so it uses these people, alliances that it has, and it hides behind these alliances. So when we criticize the ego's, what it's trying to do, it says, oh, you're a racist. You're criticizing, you know, this, my partner. You're criticizing them. And you're not really criticizing the ego. You're just upset because you're racist or sexist or whatever, you see. That's what the ego does. And you say, wait a minute, ego, you're trying to wipe out the wisdom structure of the planet that helps us focus on the Holy Spirit. And the ego says, no, that's not true. Look who you're criticizing. Like you're criticizing a person of color or something who, you know, might be advancing the ego's agenda. And you say, your objection is not towards the ego, it's really you're racist, you see. That's how the ego has been protecting itself. Or you're sexist, that's why, you know, the person, you're criticizing a woman or something, you must be sexist, and so your objection is totally invalid, and you're just trying to dress it up in some sort of spiritual talk to make it seem valid. That's the game the ego has been playing, and it's deceptive, it's a liar. Total liar. And it trades in guilt. It's got everybody in this guilt trap that we feel we cannot criticize what the ego's doing because we'll be stepping on all these precious toes, you know, of all these special people who are above criticism, you know. But no, nobody's above criticism here because we're all have one gigantic problem, which is the continuity problem. And we all struggle with that mightily. We're all quote-unquote sinners, as religion tells us. It's true. In other words, we all have this massive continuity problem. We're all defending against it terribly. And we're all identifying with the flesh. And we all are too afraid to drop this training program of death. All have the exact same problem. And we're all defending against it in various ways. And God doesn't judge anybody whatsoever. He just knows that, here we have this problem. Created the Holy Spirit. Problem solved. Okay, that's it. It's the ego that is sponsoring all the division. It is the ego that is stirring up all the trouble in the world, totally. And yet it's hiding under the skirts of the situation, as it were, and using that as protection to keep advancing its agenda. Like, how dare you, you know, criticize this wonderful, you know, a person who's doing everything possible to advance the ego's agenda. You know, how dare you criticize the ego's agenda? You're really criticizing that person. And I say, no, we're criticizing the ego's agenda and bringing it to light and praying that this person repents, and just informing them of the truth that repentance is possible for them every moment, which is true. And at the same time, saying we're not going to fall for this deceit, you know. So there is this enormous battle, and the problem is a trap's been set, a guilt trap, a severe guilt trap, and a trap of awkwardness. The ego tries to make all interactions now completely awkward. If you feel this awkwardness, I feel it intensely. Like, how do I explain to someone without them immediately, you know, demonizing me? Like, oh, you know, this is just code for you're a racist or something, or something. You know, that's what they're trying to say. And say, how do I get around that and get to these through these people? And you cannot. So every interaction is like very awkward. Like, oh, can I say this? No, I can't say that. Can I point this out? No, I can't point that out. And you get this mental awkwardness. Like, there's no, you know, smooth communication, grace-filled communication, like there used to be, certainly in this world. I'm telling you, communication was vastly better in the past. You could say things, and people would listen to you. They'd actually listen to you, instead of this immediate phobic reaction that people have of saying, ah, gotcha, you know, I pinpointed you, you're this type of bigot or something, you know, immediately, you know. Ah. So everybody's saying, the ego's telling everybody that listens to the ego, that you're blameless, you're faultless, you're perfect, nothing wrong with you, you know the way of salvation and happiness, and anybody who disagrees with you is a bigot. And people say, oh, that's easy. Problem solved. I don't have to worry about any awkwardness or anything. I just go around and someone disagrees with my point of view, oh, they're a bigot. Oh, okay, what kind of bigot are you? You know, it didn't used to be that way in the past. You said something, people would listen to you with spiritual intent, saying, okay, so what are you saying? And there's this flexibility and a trust and a love there, and say, okay, what's being said here? Let's look at what's being said here. There's no rush to judgment that you're a bigot, that kind of thing. So this rush to judgment that anyone who disagrees with the ego is a bigot is the way that the ego is structured society right now. And that is an extremely bad thing, as a matter of fact. And the Holy Spirit knows this, and is going to intervene, and is going to turn the tables, and the ego is going to be very unhappy about this, for sure. So we are truly in for it. Good and the bad and the ugly, actually. We're really in for it. I feel this tremendous anxiety. Oh my gosh, it's all coming down now really fast, and it is. And people are shrugging it off, like, oh, no big deal. No big deal. Are you kidding? You know, the prophecies are there in Scripture saying what's going to happen. And the war in the Middle East is what's going to happen, of course. Drawing the superpowers into that area, of course. So that's exactly what's happening, of course. It's all going according to script in that regard. So, again, the so-called return of Jesus, okay, hey, don't doubt it for a minute, that stuff won't happen. It's just that it hasn't happened yet, so we're all saying, oh, you know, maybe it'll never happen. Well, look what's happening in the world, and the trap that the ego has set, that's springing the trap. I think it's going to spring it on Wednesday, the 28th, it's springing the guilt trap. And I feel it. I feel it in super intense. I'm very sensitive to this. Subtle communication. And I find that your people are being labeled a racist if they don't agree with the ego's program. Okay? That's along with that, a racist, a bigot, a sexist, and every pejorative term possible. You're being pinned with that if you don't accept and agree with the ego's agenda, which is an anti-Christ agenda entirely. That is what has happened on this planet. And again, the Holy Spirit's going to do something about that. It's promised me that it will do something about that. I don't know when. I never know when, but I would say it's going to be soon now, very soon. And we're being told that the only way to get rid of this guilt is to be stupid, which is to accept the ego's guidance And then we say, now I've repented from listening, my evil ways of listening to the Holy Spirit. I'm now repented, and now I'm listening to the ego. That's the only absolution we're told that we can have. And we're looking at that and saying, well, wait a minute, that's very scary, because I spent a lifetime getting free of that. Now you're telling me I'm supposed to jump back into stupidity and insanity, believing that mutual exclusives can both be entertained in a successful, meaningful way. But that's like, you know, just completely going on into the abyss again. Jump into the abyss. That we all jump into the abyss. And that's the only way we get absolution. We live in wicked, wicked times right now. Very wicked times. And again, there are a lot of agents of the Antichrist on this planet, and they're in positions of power right now. Very much in positions of power. And they, again, are using division, racial stuff, everything they can throw at us to make us feel guilty. You know, that we're not following, you know, what the advice of the ego, you know. Because such and such is saying this, and we don't agree with what such and such is saying, therefore it means we must personally hate them, we must be bigoted towards them, which is, again, complete lie, absolute nonsense. What we're saying is what they're saying is false. And they're trying to seduce us into a false path, which leads to severe suffering, and ultimately this experience of total mental chaos, which I've experienced, and that is the worst ever. They are literally trying to seduce us into that. So of course they should be admonished. Of course we stand our ground. Of course we're being told we have no right to stand our spiritual ground. That is the meta message behind this whole thing, is we have no right to stand our spiritual ground. No right whatsoever. And that's the red line. When the elect of God, but mean those who choose to listen to the Holy Spirit, are in a position where they feel they're no longer able to stand their ground, that's when the Holy Spirit is going to act. That's the red line. It's going to come in, and it's going to give us help. And we're going to say, oh, yes, we can. Yes, we will stand our ground. Yes, we will. And we're at that point right now, because I'm feeling it. I'm feeling this anxiety attack. It wouldn't be happening if we weren't at that point, because normally I can stand my ground, but I'm aware that there's this very clever trap in the world that is literally causing us to, like, freaking us out, because we say, wait a minute, I really can't say anything to help anybody without being, you know, demonized. And of course we want to help people, so I say, boy, I just can't help anyone, otherwise I'm getting in trouble. And that's the trap. So the Holy Spirit will make its move, maybe within days, actually. And again, I said, all this is going to come sooner than you expect, but we've been preparing it for years and years and years. So it's now here. It is now here. And I'm ready for it, that is for sure. We need to coalesce and stand our ground and say no to the ego. Say, ego, we don't need you. We have the Holy Spirit. You know, we don't need your advice. We have the advice of the Holy Spirit. And we're repenting of our desire to be prime creator. We're accepting that God gave us the answer to the continuity problem, and we are now going to be free ourselves from all identification with impermanence, and we're not going to, no longer in the cycle of birth and death, you know, no longer part of that, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So our way is the lighted way, as it were. So we can redline time. We're going to get help to stand our ground, because if we don't, I'm telling you, we are going to succumb, unfortunately. That's how I feel. I feel like this panicness, because I realize I can't really talk to anybody anymore. Because I know the various things that have happened that have really caused people to crumble, actually. Crumble. In their resolve. Crumble in their resolve, you know, and think, oh my gosh, I don't want to be a bad person, you know. I don't want to be a bad person. I better agree, you know, with this insanity that's going on. So again, red line time, and comet, I, sun, I don't know, planet. Cometoid, what is it? Ison with three different speeds. Is this the comet that's got three different speeds? Slow, fast, and super fast. Does that mean this trajectory is going to be different than we're told? Etc., etc., etc. That's coming soon. In November, right? perihelion is like November or something, late November. How far away is that? See, October, September, October, it's like three months. So what we have to do now is to stand our ground. And that time is now. That time is now where we should expect a miraculous help at this time, a really miraculous thing that the ego is just going to go, oh man, you know, it's going to really fluster the ego for sure, greatly fluster it, and that's a good thing, but more than that, it's going to help us stand our ground. Okay, stay tuned, because this is all very much on right now, and hopefully we can get our sleep, but you know, I'm kind of doubting it. I am like, this whole situation is totally on right now. Okay, very great. Hang in there. That's it.